Tune up a little bit. Perfect. Father, I thank you so much for this day. Lord, I thank you for your grace, your mercy, and the gift of life that you've given all of us. I thank you for your love, for your salvation. Lord, we pray that you renew a right spirit in us on a daily basis. We just want to love you and worship you. We want to lift your name up high so everyone can know that you are life. You're the way. Your name embodies the whole heart of truth. And so, Father, today we're thankful. We're gloriously blessed because of you. Doesn't make a difference what's going on around us, oh God. There's nothing greater than you who dwells within us. Doesn't make a difference what name it has. There's no name above the name of Jesus. And Father, you are our deliverance, and you are our breath and the length of our days. We worship and we praise you and honor you. Holy.
My life, for you I live forevermore.
thankful. I'm thankful. So we come into your presence to sing a song to you, a song of praise and honor for all the things you helped us through. You gave a life worth living, a life of love with you. And now I just love giving all my praises back to you. You're the Father of creation, the risen Lamb of God. You're the one who walked away from the empty tomb that day, and you set your people free with love and liberty. And I can walk with you every night and every day. So we come into your presence, sing a song to you, a song of praise and honor for all the things you've helped us through. You gave a life worth living, Jesus, a life of loving you. And now I just love giving all my praises back to you, 'cause you're the Father of creation, the risen Lamb of God. You're the one who walked away from the empty tomb that day, and you set your people free with love and liberty. And I can walk with you every night and every day. I will walk with you every night and every day. I will dwell with you every night and every day. I'm gonna love you every night and every day. I'm gonna love you every night and every day. Praise you, Lord. What a great morning this is. Amen. And we're wanting to bring something that will give you hope and bless you. And you know, a lot of people have fought a spirit of fear which came in with this sickness, this plague, if you will, or in this pandemic. And the spirit of fear can be very powerful, but it's not more powerful than God is, and that's a fact. And so in that alone, just in that, I have a lot to rejoice over, and I do, because God is so good. And so the songs we sing, you know, this morning are songs about the fact that God loves us, He dwells with us, He's here with us. You know, I share these things all the time because in my life, it's a truth. God is always with me. He never leaves me, never forsakes me. His peace has never left me, even when this thing started off. There can be a lot of things out there that rob you of your peace and also rob you of your dreams, or dream thieves out there, if you will. The enemy, Satan, and every demonic thing out there wants to destroy your dreams. And they'll use anything they can, circumstances, situations, people, even your own family members at times, to try to destroy your dreams and try to steal and kill your life just a piece at a time. They're the Philistines that we take on every day. But you know, we picked up, like David, we pick up those smooth stones. David picked up five. Five always is a number of grace. And I always think of the Word of God as being the sword of the Spirit. But Jesus is the rock we stand on. And so those rocks to me remind me of scriptural truths that God has given us that reaffirm what Jesus has already done through His life, death, and resurrection, how He conquered the enemy for us. And now we use those stones to keep the enemy in place. Every scripture, God breathes into us. Every scripture, He breathes life into us, and it becomes a rhema word. It becomes the very thing we use against our adversary to keep him at bay. And trust me, He's everywhere. He's on TV, believe it or not. He's on a lot of news stations, too. I notice that a lot of people tend to try to say what's going to happen, and they guess and everything. You know, really, God knows what's going to happen and the timing of everything. If we listen to God, we'll be on a better path than if we listen to man. And I can't stress that enough. We need to keep our eyes on Jesus. We need to stay focused on the Lord and keep our ears attentive to the things that he speaks. He's our great shepherd. And the voice of our shepherd, we're going to recognize in the voice of a stranger, we're not going to yield to. We're just not going to do that. Graham Ord lives up in Canada, and he writes some great songs. And he wrote this song on one of his CDs. And the guy's an amazing guy. Plays great blues guitar, just a great songwriter. If you ever get a chance to get any Graham Ord, O-R-D, CDs, there's some great stuff in them. There's one especially dedicated to the Lord that he sings. And one of those songs is one I'm going to sing right now because it's perfect for right now. Take courage, Jesus is near. And because let not your heart be troubled, and don't give in to fear. Take courage, your God is near. Thank you. Praise you for being with us this morning. Every house, everyone that's watching, Father, bless them abundantly today. Let them know how much you love them. God, it's so good. I'm very excited about being here this morning and talking with everybody and getting to sing some songs with you. And it's time we're nearing, you know, I believe, the end of this age. And that the Lord maybe coming sooner than we expect. He's always telling us to be prepared and to keep our eyes out for him, because when he comes, we got to open up for him. We got to be prepared. We got to be able to hear his voice, his shout. We need our hearts always opened up to him. And when I mean open up to him, I mean keep our hearts and our ears and our eyes open so we can know. We do actually know the signs of the times. It's pretty obvious. But we know when that day is getting closer, we're prepared. Try to bring as many people into the kingdom as possible. The last opportunity for escaping the things that come in Christ is always through Jesus, because he's the answer for everything we deal with and we contend with every day. So, you know, we want to be prepared for him.
Prepare the way, prepare
us to confessions of faith and not be blown by the wind. I'm holding on to what's written on my heart, longing and looking for Him. Prepare the way. Songs, but I think I'm just going to do one. I'll just do one more. I have a whole week. You think everybody's going to stay on this online thing and watch this all week long? People are hungry for the Word of God. And Rick Devon, if you're watching, this is for you, my brother. Great, praise God. This is a song Rick Devon wrote, and he's an old friend of mine. One of the first real psalmists I ever met. Besides Mike Deese, he was the first one. And he wrote the song, and his songs are really timeless. And it's one of my favorite songs. It's got me through so many things. And if it helped me get through some rough stuff, it'll help you get through what we're going through. If you should be caught in sin, don't run away from Him, but run to His throne of grace. Seek the Lord in His face. He will never turn you away, 'cause God is on your side. If there's a giant Philistine trying to destroy your dreams, was trying to steal or kill your life, then put on the armor of light and put your trust in Jesus Christ and tell him God is on my side. You've got to reach out and take his hand and get up and go again, 'cause you can make it if you try. You can make it with Jesus Christ. You can make it if you try. Say it with me, 'cause God is on my side. God is on my side. Finally be strong in the Lord and in the power of his mind, 'cause everything be all right. Just let the Lord fight your fight and take your stand in the power of his might. And say with me, God is on my side. He paid the price for you and me, and by his power he has set us free, and we can do anything, 'cause our God dwells in you and me, and our God, he supplies all our needs, 'cause God is on your side. You got to reach out and take his hand. Get up and go again, 'cause you can make it if you try. Christ, you can make it if you try, 'cause God is on your side. Forget about your yesterdays, forget about all the things save me, just say I can make it if I try. I can make it with Jesus Christ. I can make it if I try. God is on my side. Let me sing that one part again. Really listen. Forget about all your yesterdays, all the pain, all the hurt, all that stuff. Forget about all the mistakes you say you've made. Satan always likes to use those against you, but God has covered them with the blood of Jesus. They no longer exist. You're free in Christ, and you're free indeed. Just say I can make it. If I try, I can make it with Jesus Christ. I can make it if I try, 'cause God is on my side. God is on your side. Praise God. Well, I'm going to switch over and we're going to share the word. However, I have a friend that's going to help me this morning. He's going to come up and get a hold of this microphone first, and he's going to share a few things with y'all. And Lanom is his name. So he gets to sit down here and share abundantly, and then I'll be back. Here you go, my brother.
So where's this going, my ear?
Yeah, it goes on your left ear. And you're on.
And go in the pocket or something? Get me wired up here.
Thank you,
awesome. Thank you, brother. Thank you, thank you. Well, I'm just going to stand here. Will that work for you, Kevin? That's great. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for your gifts. Thank you, Father, for your love and your care. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your gift, for the gift of your blood, for the freedom in you. Hallelujah. We have gifts, church. We have gifts. I just want to say how blessed we are to have a gift named Red Wilson. We are so blessed. Give you a background on me. My name's Lon. My wife's name is Shelley. We've been here for about 3 months now, back from Montana. And from about 1990 to 2004, we fellowship here at Aggressive and saw some amazing things and experienced awesome things in God. And you know, God's in Montana too. And we experienced all kinds of wonderful things, and now we're back here. We've got three wonderful kids and 1.5 grandchildren and a wonderful God. And I have some things to share with you today. Red said we could tag team a little bit today. So tag, Red. I'm in. I want to share with you some encouragement, some things that God has for all of us. Things that last weekend were really forefront and evident. And when Easter rolls around, I've heard about CEO Christians, Christmas and Easter only. And last week, Red mentioned that he celebrates Easter every day. And I want to encourage that. And I want to start in Isaiah. I want to start in Isaiah 40, verse 2. Here's what it says. Speak kindly to Jerusalem and call out to her that her warfare has ended, that her iniquity has been removed, and that she has received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. Double for all her sins. How are your sins treating you? This came to me 3-4 weeks ago. I was going about my day, and there were some weights on me and some things I was working through, and some things I was thinking about, and I came to the thought, and I know it was from the Lord, that, wow, I've received double for all my troubles. Double! I mean, twice of what I really need to get it covered. Church, you've received double. If you don't feel you're a Christian, Lord Jesus, pour out your double on them right now, whoever you are, wherever you are, you've received double. Don't be fearful and unbelieving. Don't draw back from the moment when he lays it on your heart. Come to him. You've received double. And since we've received double, guess what? We're free to hear other things that he has for us. You know, in Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, they're real common. They always go together. You have been saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. It is the gift of God. And we've received double for all of that. So wherever you are, how low you've been, how prideful you've been, how messed up you've been, just settle it. You've got double in the bank to cover it. But verse 10 goes with verse 8 and 9. You know what it says? You have been saved unto good works, which God prepared beforehand that you should walk in them. God knows you. God knows your name. God started with you in the womb. He knew you before then. And He has made things for you. He knows exactly who you are, what you're built for, what He has put in you, their seeds in you. You know, He says many are called and few are chosen. Well, hear the calling. Now, some are already chosen and moving in that, but hear the calling, because you all should be chosen. Well, who does it apply to? Let's see. Are you breathing on the planet? It doesn't matter where you've been, you've received double. If you're breathing on a planet, Jesus died for you, and He has a hope and a future that He wants to pour out. Receive it. Fearfulness and unbelief, get out. Fight this stuff. It's a daily thing. It's every day. You wake up, man, I don't want to get this virus. Protect me, Lord. Cast yourself into His care. Lord, I got to be able to pay my rent. Is the bank going to take my car back? They don't want my car. I already put a dent in it. Okay? Lord, provide for me. The Lord said He would provide. So rest in Him. Come to Him. We've received double. There's another thing I want to talk about here in this drawing close to God. Now, I'm a Bible guy. I'm the guy who, when he starts studying his Bible, I have 30 translations at home, and a lot of times there are 10 or 15 of them spread out over the next half acre, as well as the concordances and the lexicons and the. I'm that guy. Well, if you would, turn with me to John 5 and verse 39 and 40. It's interesting here. Jesus is talking to the Pharisees and to the scribes and those who got it all. And He says this, "You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. It is these that testify about Me, and you are unwilling to come to Me so that you may have life." Wow. Life. We as Americans, we've got a picture in our mind about what life is. We've got a thought and an understanding of what life should be about. We got our things. Well, I'm pretty sure that when Jesus said life and life more abundantly, maybe some of those were included, but they're the small parts of it. And for all you Bible scholars out there, friends, brothers, and very determined modern Pharisees, please come to Jesus. I have been a very determined modern Pharisee. I can speak to you, okay? I'm still overcoming it. And if I can overcome it, you can too. There's life in Jesus. Those who are led of the Spirit of God are the sons of God. The whole world is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. And so, several weeks ago, when I heard this in my head, you've received double, wallowing in my troubles. It's all self, just self-focused. Oh, it's just, how am I ever going to overcome this, Lord? Or how am I going to do with this? Da, da, da. You've received double on. Come up. Come up. I have other things for you to be busy with. Come up. I've created things for you to be about. Come up. You've received double. you've received double. The third thing I have to share, and then I'm going to tag out and let Red come back. It's in Proverbs 18, and it's verse 24. Now, this is an interesting thing here. It's interesting. All this stuff is just things that's current in my life that I'm going through and working through, and I'm simple enough to be able to know that the 18th was a certain day of the month, and there's an 18th proverb, and so I just pick up my Bible and go to that day of the month, and there's some reading for me. I do more than that, but there's some reading for me, and it's just a simple, good way to start. Well, this one struck me the other day. It's verse 24, and in the King James it says, "A man that has friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother." Well, that's awesome. I've always thought about that as there's a principle there. If you want friends, you got to be friendly. Well, yes, that is true. But then I read another translation. This is NAS. And here's what it says. "A man of too many friends comes to ruin, but there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother." Now, wait. That seems awful different. So I went to digging. I got out my 14 concordances and word studies and translations and was sitting there behind a pile of books. And I've noted that I've got to go to the source of life when I'm doing this stuff, because otherwise it's just tangled. It's tough. You've got to hear from the author. So I believe I heard from the author the other day. This friend, a man of too many friends, comes to ruin. Well, the word ruin, or the second word for friend, it's a word that describes being divided, having many focuses. And the second part of the verse said, "But there is a lover who stays closer than a brother." You know what? The Lord wants us to draw nigh to Him. He's given us double for all those problems that would keep us away. So church, get over yourself. You've received double. If you're not what you'd consider yourself a Christian, you've received double. You need to receive that. It's important. And God has things for you to be about. But this focus on many, many, many things can take us away from the one who really loves us and really wants to draw near. And He is near. He is near. He's right here. He will come right to you. Ask Him. Say, "Lord." If you don't hear anything in the first 2 seconds, say, "Lord." "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." Because He will speak. He's dying to speak. He died to speak. Okay? So, it's awesome being with you today. You guys have a blessed day in the Lord. You guys keep overcoming. Tag Red, you're in.
That was really good. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Okay. I should be on. I know it's good. It's just what I need to hear, especially the scriptures out of Ephesians 2. What is perfect for this morning. Perfect. So I'm just going to finish off with just a little something. So we kind of did a tag team thing today, which is good. We're going to be doing things two by twos. We don't have to use a two by two. Anyways, if you go to 2 Peter in your Bible, which is that way, to the right, I'm sure. And we're going to go to chapter 1, and then we're going to go to a different scripture. But I think what Lon is telling you this morning is really important, and I really enjoyed that. Thanks, brother. That was real good. So one of the things that we want to do is I have other teachers and ministers that have things to share that God's been sharing with them. And so, as you know, there's a time coming when we're going to start to re-enter back into things that we've done before. And that means even one day this church will be open and we'll be full of people and we'll be worshiping the Lord together. And that time is coming. And as we get closer, we'll tell you what we're going to try to do to keep everybody safe, but also keep everybody very blessed. Because the fact is, when you're blessed of the Lord, God always keeps you safe. I mean, it's true. And one of the things that I appreciate about the Lord is His promises are yea and amen. And so in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2, he says, "Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord." I've shared on this before, but it's really important to catch that multiplied word. That word multiply means that, you know, grace, which gives us great favor in the presence of the Lord, it helps us, it keeps us covered, you know, from any sins that we commit because we are under the blood of Jesus and we're saved by grace through faith. But also peace, and that's the thing that you need to have right now. If you're going to overcome the things that are going on, you know, the coronavirus is one thing, but all the side effects of having to protect ourselves and do this and that that the state and the federal government want actually exercises a certain amount of stress on everybody. Because you now have to try to not only be cautious for yourself, but also for the people around you. Imagine a disease like this is going to cause people to be more mindful of those around them. Oh my gosh, that's a God thing right there. That we're actually thinking about other people and trying to take care of them and watching over them. Isn't it amazing that in a disaster, what can be in people can surface, and what's from God can come up and what's from the enemy can come up. So you have sometimes in different disasters, you have looting and crime and other things that happen. And that's the sinful side of man that's there to try to survive at any cost. But then there are people who love God or probably know God, and all of a sudden they're thinking, how can I help somebody else? You know, and so people are feeding folks, they're dropping things off, they're running errands, they're helping people that can't get out and do stuff because they have a compromised immune system, feeding the homeless, still taking care of them and making sure they get, you know, coats and socks and, you know, sleeping bags, blankets, whatever they might need, food and stuff. And then you watch what they're doing for first responders, you know, and how first responders like firemen and police are going by little kids' houses that have birthdays that can't have a birthday party, and they're going by doing a parade and wishing that kid happy birthday. I mean, there is stuff happening now that we never really saw before. And that is becoming something that I think and hope will stay around. You know, I'm sure it will. But that part of God's beginning to surface in people. And if we recognize that, that's important because it says here, you know, because of God and the knowledge of God through Jesus Christ, look at what it says. Seeing that His divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness through the true knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and excellence. We're not only going to be having grace and peace multiplied in us through the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ, but the more we know the true Jesus, and the only way you can do that is through the Word of God and in prayer, listening to the Holy Spirit. That's how we know the true Jesus. I watched a video last night on YouTube, and this guy was saying he was Jesus Christ. But boy, what a filthy mouth. And that's not Jesus. That's not how God is. So we got to watch our words and make sure our words line up with His character and nature. So we have to fill ourselves full of God to do that. because we fill ourselves too full of other things, and what we don't want to pop out, that God in there is going to pop out, and it doesn't glorify the Lord. And it's bad on our testimony. Another thing, seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness. His power in you right now is revealing everything that pertains to life and godliness. I mean, God is revealing himself in you if you'll just take the time, spend the time with him. If we lose this time, then we lose all. But if we don't, we take advantage of this time and seek after him, we'll gain everything. It says in verse 4, "For by these he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, in order that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature," or partakers of divine nature, because the word "the" is italicized. It's the Greek strong, or the Strong's number 9999. It's added word. So if you look at without "the" and read it, it says that he has granted to his precious, or he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, in order that by them you might become partakers of divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in this world through lust. Man, that's so important. God is making us partakers of his divine nature. That means his character, which is part of his nature. That means his character is going to be formed in us. And it's going to affect our character, because his divine nature overcomes sin in our life if we'll allow it to do that. And what we don't want to do is when things begin to relax, just go back to our old ways. You never want to lose ground that you've taken. You want to gain more. You want to keep going forward and pressing in. So for that very reason, the Bible says, applying all diligence in your faith, supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence, knowledge, and in your knowledge, self-control, and in your self-control, perseverance, and in your perseverance, godliness, and in your godliness, brotherly kindness, and in your brotherly kindness, love. It says, because, for if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Just adding those things daily in your life gives you a better perspective on the true knowledge of Jesus, who he really is, who he really is in you, who he really is at the right hand of the Father, representing you to God. And that's what we want. He's always representing us. Why would we want to tempt the Lord our God? Why would we want to do things that would grieve him? I don't want to do that. And so, you know, I count on Jesus helping me through that. You know, there's another thing here. I want to share this one part out of 1 Peter chapter 2. And I'm going to close with this. This is something we can think on this week. So underline this if you can, and think about how you're becoming what's being described here. "Therefore, putting off," or putting aside, "all malice and all guile and hypocrisy and envy and all slander, like newborn babes, long for the pure milk of the Word of God, that by it you may grow in respect to salvation, if you have tasted the kindness of the Lord." Well, I think we have. So we need to get rid of that stuff. This is a great time for God to do a character adjustment in us and give us some beatitudes, the attitudes to be and to have, and to grow in those. "And coming to him as to a living stone rejected by men, but choice and precious in the sight of God, you also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For this is contained in Scripture: Behold, I lay in Zion a choice stone, a precious cornerstone, and he who believes in him shall not be disappointed." So, if Jesus is the precious cornerstone, that cornerstone was a stone used for every other stone to be patterned after and built in the exact same likeness. So you, as living stones and precious stones, are being reformed and transformed into the very character and nature of Jesus Christ. That we can offer up pure hearts of praise and worship, spirit and truth. This precious value then is for you who believe, but for those who disbelieve, the stone which the builders rejected, became the very cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, I'm sorry. For they stumble because they are disobedient to the word, and to this doom they were also appointed. So we're a chosen race. We're a royal priesthood. We're a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. That we, all of us, you and I, may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called us out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Look, we were a people that were dark. Darkness covered our lives, our hearts. And God has brought us out of darkness. He's brought us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, out of the kingdom of darkness. He's made us go from darkness to light. And he's the Father of lights, and we're lights. We're called to be lights that everyone can see, like a city set on a hill. So don't cover up what God is revealing in you. Don't cover it up. Let people see it. Let it shine and glorify the Father. Stay away from the things that are going to mess you up in this hour. Remember, the enemy will use every opportunity he can find to come back at you after the years of victory you've had. Don't give him an open door and don't give him an opportunity. Keep it all shut. Let God continue growing in your life and transforming you into his image. Continue to let the glory of God come upon you and let you shine, and let his nature and character transform you into the nature and character of Jesus Christ. So important right now. This is the heart of spiritual warfare. It's not just fighting off the devils. It's become more like Christ. Do you understand? Having the mind of Christ, the ability to understand through the wisdom of God what's going on, the ability to hear from Jesus, to perceive with your eyes what's truly happening beyond the flesh, beyond the natural, and having a heart ready for God to work in and through to accomplish his good work. And he wants to use you. He wants to partner with you. He's longing for you to be his sons and daughters. It's part of the family thing, you know. It's part of the family thing. We're all bled kin through the blood of Jesus Christ. So let's adhere to God. Let's do these things. Let what he's told us, he's given us, come to pass and not hinder it. Open our hearts, open our eyes, open our ears, and let us release our faith that what God wants to accomplish in you and through you can be done today. Not only for the glory of God, but for the benefit of those suffering around you. You know, we say God's the only one that can stop a plague. Well, he chooses to use us in doing so. And if we're not listening and hearing and doing, how can we help him do what he wants to do? So I encourage you today, stay tight with Jesus. Okay? Stay fired up for Jesus, as my brother JT from Montana would say. And let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this morning. I thank you so much for your word. For everyone watching or listening or sees this later, let them be blessed above measure. Father, encourage them. Let them hear your voice. Let the voice of the shepherd, let them hear clearly in the voice of a stranger. Let them recognize who that is and walk away from that. Lord, give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to believe. And Father, it's not what we store in our mind that counts. It's what you store in our human spirit, our heart, that makes all the difference. So we want to keep our hearts open to you in all things. Father, we love you and honor you today. We bless you in Jesus' name. We thank you for all that you do. And again, we bless you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you and God bless you. Have an awesome day.